doctor of law, Professor Vagn Greve, last year you said to the Danish media that there are countries, and you mentioned specifically the Netherlands and France and Spain, are there others, where sibling incest is not criminalized. What are the other countries?
There are a number of other countries, for instance Russia, China. In Italy, it's only a crime if it causes some sort of public uproar. As long as it's kept private, it's completely legal also in Italy. In Sweden, half-siblings can get the permission from the government to even to marry, which means that once a year they'll have a case in Sweden where two persons, half-brother, half-sister, will marry. Whereas if they had intercourse in Denmark, it would be a crime. So Denmark is absolutely in a very specific position, seen in a comparative perspective.
So numerically, would you say half of the countries of the EU permit sibling incest, while the other half does not?
Well, I'm not prepared to count it in that way. And then, will you count inhabitants or number of countries, or how will you do it? But there are enormous differences. Also, if you go to the United States, you will see enormous differences inside the United States, whether it's a very severe crime or it is something like just a petty crime or not a crime.
Are there any states in the United States of America,
yes,
where incest is legal?
Now we are, of course, only talking about incest between grown-ups. It's a crime,
yes,
all over,
yes, yes,
if it's there's a child involved. Mm. But also in the United States, there are states where it's just a petty crime.
But there are differences.
Yes.
The countries, some countries have limitations, or it's completely illegal.
Mm-hmm.
Please elaborate on how it came to be that some countries in the EU, for example, like Denmark, incest is a crime, and you get suspended sentences for it. In Denmark, right?
It's not only suspended sentences; you get a prison sentence for it. It's not a short one, so it is definitely not only a crime in the book, but also a crime in fact out in the real world. And the reason for that is that we always think that the Scandinavian countries are very liberal in moral perspectives, that we are very liberal concerning different sorts of sexual behavior. But in fact, we are very much influenced by Luther and the Orthodox movements inside the Christian beliefs after around the year 1500, when we had the Reformation and whatever took place in that period. And we had kept this very severe way of regarding this as a crime. And we have in Danish the word blodskam, which means you are really going down to the blood, you are really committing a crime which is completely against human nature. That's what the Danish word is saying in this respect. But it's only a crime in a very few countries, and it cannot be defended as a crime in our countries anymore, if it has ever been possible to defend it.
It sounded like you said that religion, Lutheranism, at least in Denmark, is the source of this criminalization.
We very often consider the Catholic Church, the Roman Catholic Church, as a church with very high morals and very easy to condemn people for behaving in a different way and having some sort of sexual life which is not completely in accordance with the Bible or the religion. But in fact, the Roman Catholic countries are much more liberal than the Lutheran countries. It's the Protestant countries which are in this way condemning sexual behavior which is not completely according to the book.
Historically, I've heard that the old Roman Empire had the most stringent and extensive laws against every imaginable relationship that even slightly reminded one of some form of incest. Is Denmark's and other countries' current prohibition against sibling incest nothing more than legal leftovers from ancient Rome? You mentioned Lutheranism, but maybe ancient Rome went even further back, and they were very strict. Is it possible to speak of anywhere in Europe of legal leftovers from ancient Rome, if it is true, and I don't know if you agree with me, true that the ancient Rome actually had extremely stringent laws of incest?
Well, if you see, look at the countries which are very much influenced by the old traditional Roman law, it's countries like Italy, Spain, France, Portugal, and that's the same countries where it's are very liberal in this respect. So, actually, there's no reason to blame the old Romans for this. What we see is that in all countries, you see very different patterns in family life. The way families are constructed in different countries are very different. But in all countries, families are considered the basis for the whole society, the basis on which the whole society is built. And therefore, you very often see that some crimes against the families will be considered not only crimes against individual persons, but also crimes against the whole structure in of the society. And therefore, when we have had debates of this sort, and we have had exactly the same debate about homosexuality, we have the same debate around prostitution, we have had the same debate around sexual intercourse with other persons than the ones you are married to. Every time you see that people will say, now the society is going completely down because now you're spoiling the family, you're spoiling the deep moral feelings in the family, and therefore the society will no longer continue. But if you look into it, we have abolished, there's a crime in Denmark to have prostitution, we have abolished sexual intercourse outside marriage, we have abolished being a crime to be a homosexual, etc., etc. The only one which is of these special crimes left over is incest. And if you try to ask people who defend this criminalization of incest, they very often say it's because if people are marrying each other, we know from all our knowledge about cows and pigs and all other sorts of animals, then you'll end up with sorts of sick animals. It would be animals with different sorts of handicaps. And they would say, it's exactly the same here. We are protecting the human race in this way. Actually, if you are having a child and you are not in, it's not inside the family, there is a risk around 2-3% for having a child with some sort of handicap or illness. If it's inside the family, it's something like 5-6%. So you see, it's around 2% more than the 3%, which is the ordinary. But is that sufficient reason for making a crime? At least it cannot be a sufficient reason for making a crime to have a homosexual relationship. But also, today we do not any longer have crimes as we had for the purity of the race, etc., etc., as we all know them from Germany. Actually, Denmark started out before Hitler took power in Germany and made the same sort of laws. We have laws in this way protecting the human race is exactly the same way as we're protecting our animals from getting handicaps. But they have all been abolished in Denmark in the 1960s. And today we know quite a lot of illnesses or handicaps which 50% of the children will get. And it's not prohibited to marry, it's not prohibited to get a children, even if we know as a scientific truth that 50% of their children will have a handicap. Then it is...
So that would be discrimination if one went against handicapped
people,
right?
But then we still use it as an argument for raising the percentage from around 3 to around 5% the Guardian says, things do simply not fit together.
This reminds me a little bit about the debate that has been very heated a couple of years ago anyway, in Denmark and other places, I guess, about cousin marriages. Cousin marriages, especially from people who have a lineage from Pakistan and have immigrated to Denmark, and they get married with close kin cousins.
And it has been used, as you say, as an argument for criminalizing it or prohibiting that sort of marriage. But actually, what we are talking about is exactly what took place in Hitler's Germany and in other countries at the same time. Also in Denmark, also in the United States, it was the same way of thinking, this biological way of thinking, to get healthy people, to get the real healthy Aryan people coming out of it. And this way of telling us that people who have a handicap are not as good people, do not have the same rights, cannot be regarded as human beings of the same value as the rest of us who do not have a handicap. That's really the worst way of old biological Nazi thinking. If you consider people having the same rights and being, just because they are human beings, also they have the right to have our full respect and the full rights in society, you cannot say we do not like cousin marriages because a higher percentage will be people we do not like because they get a handicap. It's people we should avoid having as children. This way of thinking is, to me, simply some of the worst.
It's racism, isn't it?
It's completely, it's inside the same race. I don't know whether it can be called racism.
Okay.
It's the same way.
Well, it would be racism in the sense that it's against cousin marriages in a certain context, immigrants coming from Pakistan being Muslims. So it could be.
But ones who are asking for a prohibition do not limit it to the Pakistani, but they will also say it ought to be the same for all people who have been living in Denmark for centuries.
Has there been a straight development from prohibition since the Roman times until today? Has it only been one way, or have countries shifted back and forth, legalizing and criminalizing incest throughout history? Or is there? Can you talk about a general tendency?
No, everything goes ups and downs inside. Also,
okay. Also, because of the
legal system, we just look at the development in our countries during the last 30, 40 years. We thought that we were very liberal. We decriminalized pornography. We decriminalized other sorts of sexual behavior. Today, we are rolling it back. We are criminalizing more and more pornography today. Mm-hmm. We are seeing a neo-puritanism coming up in the society in lots of ways, the way we handle sex with teenagers, etc., etc. We are seeing how the wheel is going backwards today to more of a Puritanism than we had 30, 40 years ago. And we have seen through history the same pattern. I mentioned that the Catholics had a much more liberal way of looking at sexual behavior. We had, for instance, lots of prostitution going on in Copenhagen up to the Reformation, then it was prohibited. And we see that in all respects. But there are two big differences, two main points, milestones. One is the period of the Enlightenment. And because of the period of Enlightenment, we abolished the way of defending crimes.
So the Enlightenment, when was this? Was that the Renaissance or after the Renaissance?
18th century.
18th century, okay.
And up to that time, it was the argument was that we ought to have this crime, we must have this crime because it says so in the Bible. But from then on, You couldn't use the Bible as sufficient reason for criminalizing something, and therefore people started thinking themselves. And in that period, we saw the first development towards the decriminalization of incest. Another thing was after the different sorts of revolutions in Russia, China, etc., etc., where they threw out the old system and that influence from the church, and also saw a much more liberal way of thinking.
With respect to the to Holland and Netherlands and France, which where incest is legal, has it been illegal? And do you know when it was a crime in these countries, and when did it change?
I think that all countries had it as a crime if you go back to the middle of the 18th century. So what has taken place is a development at different periods in different countries since the Enlightenment took over. And actually, when you are discussing what will happen if you decriminalize sibling incest between grown-ups in Denmark, and you listen to arguments about all the handicapped children, you'll see how society breaks down because the family breaks down, but actually they have no more handicapped children in the other countries. Their families, their societies are working as well as ours.
Have there been, during the Enlightenment, the middle of the 1800s, things were legalized in the countries we mentioned. Were there social movements that demanded change that maybe pressured politicians to legalize these things? Do you know anything about that? Were there any movements demanding legalization in these countries? Or
there was a very strong movement demanding the freedom of the people, of demanding human rights, demanding that it was up to people themselves to decide in all respects.
Which movement was this?
Well, it's a part of the Enlightenment movement.
Okay.
And this is it's exactly the same. If you go back to the middle of the 18th century, it was the state which decided what sort of work you could have, how much money you could earn, what sort of dresses you had to wear. It was controlled by the state, everything. And that one of the big parts of the Enlightenment was that you leave the decisions to people themselves. People are rational. People can be trusted to decide for themselves. And that had an enormous influence in all areas of law, not only this.
It sounds like one cannot say that these legalizations in the Enlightenment period took place. One cannot say that it was without a debate. There must probably have been a very long-standing debate, which was the Enlightenment, I guess.
Well, there are debates all the time, back and forth regarding all sorts of laws. Some are changed easily, but usually you have long debates going on, and that was exactly the same. You got the liberalization of your right to work, what sort of work you wanted to have, etc., etc. It took place in the 1850s in Denmark, other periods in other countries.
Are there any instances of the legislators passing laws behind closed doors, or just somehow being able to avoid public debate, and they just do it for whatever reasons they might have?
Well, that has of course been a part of dictatorships. It was a part of all the kingdoms in Europe, where the king had the sole power, as he had in France and Prussia and Denmark and Tsar and Russia, etc., etc. All legislation took place by closed doors, but after we got democracy in the different countries, of course, all laws have been passed in the public debate, in parliament, with newspapers reporting. Then we have had dictatorships in other periods, Spain, Portugal, Germany, Italy, etc., etc., and they passed lots of laws in different areas. Someone in the area of morals, but lots of laws in other places. So there's nothing specific around this.
Okay, okay. It sounds like everything sort of took maybe a kind of open debate pattern in modern times. An example, the Danish gay movement, which I have known very well and even been a part of for a long period, they have been extremely active in supporting progressive legislation concerning homosexuals. And this, it sounds like you're saying that this is the normal way of doing things in a democratic society. is that a leading question?
There would be lobbying groups, but if you are talking about the Danish Association for Gays and Lesbians,
yeah,
and you're saying that they have been trying to push forward progressive laws, they have also been trying to push forward laws which are not at all progressive. But
for example,
that you're not allowed to express your opinion on homosexuality. It's a crime.
Does the gay movement say that?
Yes.
They don't want you to say, it's like the Holocaust deniers in Germany or something, this freedom of expression.
And they have been successful. It's a part of Danish law today.
Okay, the blasphemy laws or what?
No, it's not blasphemy. Because homosexuals are not gods.
No, okay, but not yet. Okay.
But when you're talking about progressiveness, it depends from which side you're seeing it.
Yeah, okay, okay.
Because looking at it from the side of freedom of speech, they have not been progressive.
Do you go, do you support a total freedom of speech legal situation?
Total. There are no lawyers supporting anything total. Mm.
But there is the Danish law on freedom of speech, expressing derogatory or very negative anti-Muslim, anti-gay expression.
Well, you use expressions like hate speech or something like that.
Yeah, okay. And that's prohibited. Do you support the abolition of this 266 paragraph B?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Well, how can you then protect people that will be subject to hate speech?
How can you have a country where it's the state who defines what you are allowed to say and how you are allowed to think? This is not a state I prefer to live in. I do not like a state which wants to decide what sort of books I can read, what sort of expressions I can use.
You want to get rid of this restriction on freedom of speech. Where are the limitations of freedom of speech?
Well,
in your mind?
Well, I think we'll have another 2 hours argument about
to
the legal details in this respect.
Okay, okay, okay. I remember there was a debate in Sweden, a debate on legalizing sibling incest, and maybe you can tell me if it was sibling incest or was it also cousin or an expansion of full cousin relationship.
Well, there was and has been a debate going on in all the Scandinavian countries in different periods, and as I said, today the situation is in Sweden that you allow half sisters, half brothers to marry, and that's of course the result.
That's legal now.
It's legal now.
But what was the debate on in 1983? That was a full legalization, not just half.
Well, it's not a crime. But there's, of course, different sorts of limitations. And even if it's not a crime to have a sexual intercourse, it might be prohibited to go into a marriage together. And therefore, in Sweden, they're prohibiting full sisters and brothers to marry, whereas half sisters and brothers would have to have the permission of the government if it's given freely around once a year.
What about sexual relations? They are totally free in Sweden, between siblings? If they're above a certain age?
If they're above that age, yes. Yeah.
Then it's completely free. Okay. Was this the result of the debate in 1983?
It has been a debate going on for a long time, and different parts have been up in different years.
And maybe you just actually explained it, but I didn't catch it. Was there in this 1983 debate, at that period, were there any within the years at that time, were there new laws passed opening up for more freedom within certain incest relations?
There have been different laws passed in different years in Sweden, broadening the legal area of, as I said, crime, marriage, etc.
Can you recall from that period or some other period in modern times in Sweden, Denmark, Scandinavia? Can you mention any groups or political parties that are very much for or against a liberalization of incest?
Well, it has, if you're talking about freedoms, it has usually been, depending on what sort of freedom it is, it depends on it, and very often it has been the conservatives defending the families and the old way of sexual behavior, whereas it has been other parties defending the freedom of people. And that you can find both on the left and the right side of we have a number of parties in different countries. In Denmark, we will see that, for instance, Labour, which is often considered the leftist party, in regarding moral question, very often has been on the same line as the Conservatives. So it's not the same pattern as you will find when you're talking about bourgeois on one side and socialist on the other.
Well, wasn't it, if I recall correctly, I don't know if I do, but the Danish pornography law, the liberalization of pornography, picture pornography, and maybe it was even written pornography too, in the late 60s, wasn't it a conservative minister of justice?
Yes, it was.
Who legalized this, who proposed it? And
yes, it was Thestrup, who was minister of justice at that time, who did that. So, but again, it's not easy to put down which sort of parties will defend this.
Or groups of people, or whatever.
Yeah.
Finally, it would be interesting for us to hear what considerations you feel are most relevant to our topic today, that obviously has moral as well as legal implications. Mm-hmm.
Well, if you are to limit people's behavior, and now I'm talking about grown-ups, rational people, not insane people, not people being used by us, but people, rational, healthy people who are living together. It's up to people themselves to decide what sort of sexual life they are going to have. It's not up to the state to decide that.
I want to say thank you very much for letting us talk to you, and I'm sure the viewers will appreciate it very much too. Thank you.